Hey, weirdlings.
All right, let's talk about what matters. If yeah. I say it's
it sounds
a Dorito,
like an album track.
If I say nacho cheese Doritos plus shredded lettuce and meat, you're like, that's an even better Doritos,
that's
right?
A better taco,
yeah.
too.
Well, yeah, yeah. Or if I say tacos with the flavor of Doritos. If I say a really soggy Cheeto that melts into goo in your mouth, yeah. What about that makes you excited for soggy Cheeto?
So, all right. So what is the mac and Cheeto? Explain the mac and Cheeto to me.
It is a Cheeto puff-shaped food nugget.
It's a mozzarella stick with shells in it, basically. And yeah.
Yeah, it's got the tube macaroni inside with cheese, and then it's deep fried.
So it's both unlike mac and cheese and unlike a Cheeto.
Well, yeah. That's the thing
but
that blew me away.
But they decided to combine the two.
That's what blows me away, is it doesn't really taste like a Cheeto.
Right.
Like, it doesn't even look like a Cheeto. It looks like a Cheeto Puff, but when I think Cheeto, I think the little scrawny little...
Yeah, I'm on
things.
Team Puffs, but I won't hold that against you.
Because you want to know what? All right. Is this the most embarrassing fast food item ever?
No. Hold on. That was a knee-jerk reaction.
I will say this. Because I know that I have the unpopular opinion on it, I think the KFC Double Down is probably the most embarrassing, but I
so
love
that's,
that.
All right, the two that I
Wait,
would
what,
say.
What was the Double Down again?
It was a sandwich where the bread was chicken, and it had bacon and cheese and sauce. Yeah. Was yeah, it, no carbs.
I mean, first of all, it's covered in carbs. They literally bread it with carbs.
whatever.
Wow. Okay.
So I would say... For as ridiculous as the Double Down is, and I will not come before you and say that the Double Down is not ridiculous.
It's crazy.
There are at least culinary precedents to stuffed chicken. This is just a fancy way to do stuffed chicken that's fried, right? And yeah, right. So, like, it's in this kind of weird packaging, but the culinary tradition for it is just kind of there. Now, the other thing that people say... because it got famous off that Patton Oswalt routine, is the big bucket of what like the sadness pit and failure pile KFC did.
The mashed potato bowls.
That was just a big ass bowl of mashed potatoes with a bunch of like treasures inside of it.
I love that too, though. I think it's also pretty
good. Wait a minute.
Good.
So what was the conceit of this? I missed all
famous
this.
The famous bowl.
Yeah.
Sergeant
so it's
Huff
got
reminds us.
Mashed potatoes, corn, cheese, and bits of chicken in a bowl, like a burrito bowl, but it's a Southern American bowl. Basically.
Got it.
But so. And not Southern American like South America, southern part of the United States of America. But there, you're just recreating what everybody makes the day after Thanksgiving, right? Everybody's done that, where you just throw it all in a bowl. You don't get enough for everything, so you just toss the little bits of leftovers all in one bowl and you eat it. Everyone's done that. I submit to you that this... like mozzarella stick monstrosity might be the worst, most embarrassing fast food ever.
Ooh. I think I think another contender in concept but not in execution is the brief like 18 months where Taco Bell had French fries. But
yeah,
those
Del
fries
Taco
were good.
Still rocks French fries.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Separate from all of this,
okay.
I will be utterly shocked if anybody remembers this, but Oh Boy Oberto is the brand that you best know for
jerky.
That's right, beef jerky. They had, at the height of the anti-carb revolution, chips that were made of beef.
Beef chips.
Crispy beef chips.
So what, they were like dried, like
they were cut ultra thin. Yes, crisps. They look like potato chips.
They look like pepperonis that you cooked too
long. Like super dried pepperoni.
But then when you bit them, they went in a very pleasing mouthfeel way. Sure. They were kind of amazing. Lasted about 20 minutes.
You're riding. You're riding for the Oberto. Are they still around?
No. They lasted 20 minutes. Look, F. They got an F on Food Facts.
Well, but that's the health score, right?
I'm sure.
Well, this is like
it has fine. I mean, like the life cycle on these have got to be forever, right? Someone's got to have them.
No way. If they're still around, that's a whole. That's three episodes of Night Attack where you and I find and eat a bag of these chips and describe them.
All right. Well, here, I'm just going to put that out into the world and see if Chat Rome can bring us back.
There's a blog post here that is 11 years old that has an outdated
amazing!
Link.
Wait, what about Olestra? Where do we put Olestra in here?
Well, I mean, so now we're kind of segging from fast food to junk food.
Yeah.
Olestra might be the greatest scandal in junk food history, considering it steered junk food right into the neighborhood it doesn't want to have, which involves anal leakage.
Olestra may cause abdominal cramping and loose stools.
Oh, were you ignorant of this? Oh, this is wonderful.
Is this like that ally thing?
Anal leakage entered into the public lexicon.
There was a blog where their official position was like, okay, anal leakage, that's an exaggeration. Everything will be fine. So a dude started blogging. This is around 1999, where all he did was eat nothing but Olestra potato chips, and he just took a photo of his underwear every day.
Ah!
And it got horrifying after like 5 days.
This is pre-Supersize Me. This is before Morgan Spurlock. Like, this is, anal leakage.
Yeah, add the word Olestra. Underwear. Add the word underwear. You got an Olestra blog underwear, and I don't even think they were calling it blogs back then.
Do not put this on screen. Just you watch
okay,
it, Bryce.
I'm gonna see if I can
react to it.
There you go. I think that's it.
I think that's just an underwear blog.
Oh, no, you're right. Yeah, it is. It's way too spit. You may have to go to archive.org.
Maybe.
Oh, dude.
Yeah. No, Olestra's got to be. Olestra was the new Coke for junk food.
Yeah.
And worse, because New Coke was just not popular. It didn't make your butthole leak.
Well, and what's funny is New Coke demonstrably was superior to Old Coke. It was just an utter and complete failure of branding that they couched it as, hey, that thing that we've sold you for as long as you can remember, we now think it's shit and we're going to replace it with something better, which is the dumbest shit ever. Because what they don't mention was that Coke had changed their formula like 8 times beforehand. This is the first time that they decided to announce it.
Yeah. But that was also like, that was the big reaction to Pepsi, right? They wanted something.
Correct. Well, Pepsi was, here's the funny part, is Pepsi had not taken number one. Pepsi demonstrably showed that the Pepsi challenge and double blind testing did not resonate with listeners and viewers. Yeah. And so Coke was like, yeah, we feel a little bit threatened. We're going to do our own Pepsi challenge against ourselves. And we came up with a better me.
Holy shit. There's an Oberto factory outlet.
What?
In.
There's one here.
Seattle, Washington.
Oh, dude, are you going to Seattle, Washington?
All right, who are you talking to?
You.
No.
No. Somebody from Seattle, Washington has a flying trapeze instruction company, and they want me to go there. And I assume that literally any of us who go to Washington can go learn to fly on a trapeze.
Do you think that they got those crisps there?
At the outlet store?
Yeah.
They're so old.
Oh, my God. Amazing is that after show picture?
Which one?
On the right hand side.
Oh yeah.
Oh I mean, how old?
Hey, by the way, congratulations, Brian.
Hey, congratulations to you too, man. We won.
Yeah, we won.
Yeah, it's the
so that's real. It opened bigger than Dory.
Yeah, it did. It did. It did.
And it's apparently kind of a shitty movie too.
Yeah, which who called that? This guy. It's a shitty, shitty trailer, shitty movie.
I'm sorry, everybody. Please build a statue of Brian out on that bold ledge, you know, to say that The Secret Life of Pets might not be a good movie.
Yeah,
and man. Also, it looks like Ghostbusters. Funny movie. People are.
That's not what the review I watched said. It was not kind. Did you watch it? Somebody.
The dude who kept coming back to me was because I was posting actual critics reviewing it. The actual critics who have reviewed it have been fairly.
I got
kind.
Sucked into his 20-minute rant about it.
No, I mean, so basically, here are the reviews as best as I can summarize them. It's a funny movie. It's at its best when it is most like a Paul Feig movie. Kate McKinnon's the star of it, or the standout star of it. And if it has like the greatest thing that keeps coming back up and up and up again is like, yeah, it's kind of beat for beat Ghostbusters, which, I mean, listen, after Phantom Men, or sorry, after Force Awakens, after Jurassic World. Like, yeah, no, that seems to be the way that it goes.
Yeah.
Here, all I'm saying is, like, as long as it is not just a universally panned piece of garbage, like, that's all we need. It's like,
again, yeah, for anybody just tuning in, all that matters is the lens through which we're looking is, you know, do we win the movie draft and it looks really good?
Yeah, I mean, listen, here's I have no horse in this, like, they're ruining the spirit of Ghostbusters and you're a bunch of man haters and yeah, like, whatever, man. I think we should all go and see for ourselves. As soon as it opens, we should all go to the theaters. And we should see Ghostbusters.
Let's teach the controversy. That's what we say. Exactly. There's only one way to be fully informed going into this, and that's if all of us see the movie before we say we hate it.
They start putting stickers on the tickets. Ghostbusters may or may not be a good movie, but...
Hey, man, look. Yeah, it's important that we discuss it.
Yeah. Listen, it's not a good movie. It's not a bad movie. It's the movie you need to see this Friday in theaters.
I know we got to get started, but did you happen to watch the final episode of Dan Harmon's history show?
Oh God, no.
Doesn't even matter. It's so, like, the first 30 seconds are so depressing, and it sets the tone where it's like, it's almost as though in the background the story's happening, and really what it's about is the fact that they're canceled. It's. It might be worth spending 30 seconds just to look at the beginning.
Because we put the whole stream on YouTube, I would maybe want to hold off until then.
Wait, well, what does that mean? You never show anything on YouTube? On YouTube?
Okay.
No. I'm seeking clarity. Like, are
because
we?
Because for weird things, we put the whole stream up on YouTube.
I see. But we don't do that for.
We don't do that.
Yeah, that's just our. We don't cut it into after show. Pre-show.
Right. Got it.
It's the one thing.
We can watch it after.
I'll watch it myself. Okay. And I'll have Brian on the phone.
Sure.
All right, guys. We ready to do this thing?
So wait, hold on. How much? We totally won this, right? Because we're at 516 now.
Oh, yeah. No.
Amtrekkers in the Peter out phase of Finding Dory.
Oh, no. Our only competition is DTNS. It is Star Trek Beyond and Suicide Squad versus Ghostbusters and Secret Life of Pets. And so far,
and
Secret
right
Life
now,
of Pets,
looking,
yeah.
Good.
Everything looks really, really good.
You have an $8 million buffer.
Yeah. Yeah, that was fast. No, that, by the way, that number does not reflect the $106 million opening weekend. I think that only has the Thursday night midnight previews in there.
This was updated yesterday, but
yes, correct. And yesterday, I don't think the numbers were out for the weekend. Right.
Cool. All right, you guys gonna do this?
I guess.
Let's go. All
right, well, take it away, somebody, in 3, 2.
Hello and welcome to Weird Things. I'm Andrew Main, joined as always by Brian Brushwood.
I'm Justin Robert Young. And as always, my sidekick, Brian Brushwood.
And I'm Brian Brushwood, joined as always by Justin Robert Young.
Hugh Downs. That and more on 2020.
And Andy Rooney, don't forget. Hey, guys, if you haven't figured it out, Andrew Main is not among us. He's not among the living people who are currently doing this episode of Weird Things. So instead, it's Justin Robert Young, me, Brian Brushwood, and, of course, Bryce Neshcom Castillo, our fabulous producer. Thank you so much for joining us.
Sure, I'm glad to be here.
So let's dive back into something that we were talking about last week, which was the unfortunate... and the unfortunate tragedy in a Tesla automobile while the autopilot feature was on. When we last left this discussion, we had made our points. Brian, if I'm incorrect in summarizing your position as, hey, look, this is something that statistically is going to happen, and by the numbers, statistically has been proven to be safer than not having.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, my exact quote was, hey, you want to make a robot omelet? You're going to have to break 30% fewer statistical eggs.
My point, and wholly agreeing with what the meat of what you guys were saying, my only thought was that Tesla going forward might have to reassess how they use the term beta. And either in explaining what it is or calling it a beta, it is a very tech community kind of jargon, right? Gmail famously, while becoming the world-class free email service, was still a beta, quote-unquote, project from Google for years and years and years, far past it becoming a dominant player. And now, in Germany... there seems to be a confusion with the government over the term beta. The German Transportation Safety Commission, for which I don't know exactly how they word it, said that they would not have approved Tesla's autopilot because they say that if beta means not fully completed, then it shouldn't be on German roads.
I'm going to hush my mouth and hear Bryce's take first.
I understand it. I understand a transportation authority saying if this feature isn't fully realized, then it could potentially create unforeseen incidents. Obviously, you have to break a few eggs sometimes, but when you're dealing with especially a huge feature like this that could potentially say let people be distracted, and we've seen videos of people sleeping in their Teslas, I understand that stance.
Elon Musk came out and said, well, if you are to be snarky, he kind of had one of those Steve Jobs, you're holding it wrong moments where he just said, no, you just don't understand what beta means. Beta means that this is this service that has not run a certain amount of miles. It doesn't mean incomplete. It means that it is in a process for which it naturally has to be at before we can say, based on actual usage and mileage, that it is out of beta.
Well, Brian, so let's actually, it's a good thing I took 10 seconds to achieve inner peace. But let's address the larger question of, is it or should it be allowed for willing participants to engage in an activity outside of regulations, right? Like, so if you're going to sell a car and you're going to proclaim it, like it drives itself or whatever, my guess is some kind of governmental entity is going to want to do some tests and find out what it does and doesn't do to decide if it's legal or whatever. But in this case, you have a willing participant on both sides. One side saying, we are trying to achieve this thing. Would you like to engage in it with the understanding that it is your job as a beta tester, as a tester of this product, to keep your hands on the wheel and make sure that if anything weird happens, all you have to do is grab the wheel and control it, and you will guide it to safety, and you will give us valuable feedback on whether or not this works and in what kind of situations. The question is, should that activity be legal? And in the United States, I think that in general, we tend to have a very rugged individualist attitude, and we feel like, you know, each person is in charge of their own kingdom and so on. And so it's like, yeah, no, I understand exactly what you're saying. We don't know if this will work. I feel like I would rather test it myself than not. And in Germany, I guess what we're hearing from, and by the way, I assume all of Germany didn't say this. I assume a person in Germany said this, right?
A person in the government.
This is Germany's Federal Office for Motor Vehicles, the KBA.
Okay, that's fine. First, okay, so a guy who does not speak for the country said something about the country. That's fine. I actually believe a lot of people in Germany don't feel this way. But the question is, like, what does it mean to have freedom? And one of the things it means is that it means the freedom to engage in something stupid. I am a person who for 23 years has made my living putting my own life in danger. It is what I do. Every single day on stage, I drink poison that may, in fact, ultimately kill me. And I do it for the engagement of the audience. Everybody in the audience goes to watch the threat of a person killing himself live on stage. Maybe it's just an America versus Germany thing, but it seems like I'm okay with that. If both parties are engaged, it's fine. The only this story would be very, very different if the story was a Tesla automobile had killed another person. I guarantee you that is the story that their media department is on ultra high alert for. They are not on alert for a person gets killed in their car, because when you run an automobile manufacturer, it is a fact that people who buy your products are going to die in your product.
Well, let's get back to this one semantic argument. The word beta. Is it incumbent upon Tesla if, as Elon Musk has said, you are confusing what beta means, to not use that term?
No.
Should they use a different term if it is found confusing by either regulatory authorities in this country or elsewhere, or consumers in general, as this becomes
And that's the question, is really Google inadvertently shifted what the word beta means to make it feel like a more complete product. As somebody who's beta tested a number of video games, I think beta has traditionally meant. So you have alpha, which means it kind of works.
Wild West. Like we have a minimum functioning product, but if you play it or use it without it crashing or losing something, then like great. Mm-hmm. But you are likely, like, you are there to run into the walls, you know, that we don't realize are there.
Right. Then you have closed beta, where it's like, we're pretty sure we have a viable product. Now we need to start cataloging all the things that are wrong, but we don't want to show it to everybody because we think it would damage our reputation and the excitement about this. Oftentimes what they would look for in video games is like specifically people who have beta tested on other games. And it's a big deal when you get accepted into the closed beta on there. But then you have open beta, which now we get into the Gmail thing. And I do understand semantically, semantically, nothing has changed, but from a popular understanding position, I think Gmail really made it to where everyone thought like, oh, beta means they're just not charging for it yet, which is not the case.
Well, and I think of like what alternative words could be used, like something like experimental or in development, but this is a product that Tesla, for as far as we can tell, intends to have this available on every car it can going forward. So it's not even like this is a maybe experimental sort of thing.
Well, I mean, so what, and I will do my best to summarize what I am going to assume is Tesla's position. Their position is what, because as Brian described, the development stages, I think, is in line with what they're saying. That they have a closed beta, I'm sure, where they went and they drove X amount of miles based on their own testing. And once they were secure with that, the next phase of doing this is putting it out on the road based on everybody else's feedback, right? And specifically, when you are dealing with software or a service or an app or something, you are looking at a similar problem. Now that you've tried it with a small group, you need to try it with a larger group, because once it's a final product, there is no going back. It's not like you can take the big public thing if it's a success and then say, no, now nobody gets it. We're going back to the 12 people. So it's got to scale up to what it is going to do. And I think when something is as low stakes comparatively as an app, a service, a video game, if a beta is perfect and ready to roll, cool. If a beta kind of sucks and has a lot of problems, you can say, hey, it's a beta. We'll fix it, or we're fixing it now. I don't know if, and this was the point I was making last week, if those, because we have understood those stakes to be so low in this tech field, that once you go to the huge stakes of putting a car out on the road, and failure can equal and will equal death, because there is no such thing as a safe automotive technology.
Right.
Whether or not that phrase becomes more of a hindrance.
So your question, if I'm hearing it correctly, is it incumbent upon yes, semantically, we understand that beta from an engineering point means it's not complete. We want to test and identify bugs. But you're saying if absent that, separate from that, beta means something to the public, is it incumbent upon Tesla to figure out a phrasing that more clearly conveys the experimental nature of this product? And I would say literally anything you call it will change absolutely nothing. If it was called Death Drive, and when you clicked Death Drive, it said, warning, this product will drive you around a lot and at some point will steer you into a wall and kill you. Please select yes, no. And people would hit yes, and they would do the exact same crap they're doing. They would be playing Battleship while their cars drove around until they ran into a wall. I think beta changes absolutely nothing. And more importantly, if they were to come up with a new terminology, the thing is they get to rely on the legal meaning of beta software. Right now, there is precedent for what beta means that they get to lean on in the event of the software not working. If they go off and make up some other word, then they are establishing their own precedent. They have nothing to stand on, no scaffolding. I think that would be an extraordinarily bad idea.
Well, I mean, no matter what, you're going to have to page through a, like, do you understand that this is a thing you're doing? Like, yes or no. And ultimately, that would be their legal protection, you know, beyond what, you know.
No. Well, that's just it. Is right now you're saying beyond the word beta, at least they have the structure and the precedent, because based on precedent.
Well, let me just, I mean, I guess, so my point was, and we can move off this, because this is such a pedantic, stupid point, but that if Germany says, hey, look, they're calling it a beta means incomplete. We don't want incomplete things on our roads. Would that be, I guess, unless I'm putting words in your mouth, your point is it wouldn't matter whether or not the fact that, like, right now they're debating over the meaning of beta. That dude would have said, hey, that's a dangerous feature. No matter what, he would have found a way to say this is a dangerous feature and I'm not comfortable with it on German roads, whether or not it was called beta or, you know, future add-on or research, whatever. You know, in that regard, a reason to say something bad about it.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, it sounds to me like these are the things you say when a disaster happens, not in your country, and you want to say some words that will garner favor with people above you in a bureaucracy. You say like, well, I never would have done that. That's what this boils down to. This guy says, I would never have missed that 3-point shot, which is a horse crap thing to say and has no bearing on this discussion. And it was a small thing to say by a small person in a small country, America, 2016.
There does, and this will be the final word on this, but there is some significance to this official making his opinion clear. Autopilot has been given approval by the Netherlands, but Germany is Europe's biggest car market. So if this is a signifier that there would be issues going forward, then it could possibly affect Tesla's growth overseas. But yeah, who knows exactly how much.
Maybe, I don't know. It just sounds like so many words. It sounds like a bunch of talky talk that won't matter. I mean, look, some bureaucrat somewhere says he wouldn't have missed that 3-point shot. It won't matter when 3 years from now, all of Germany is rioting because, like, why are we killing our citizens every year by allowing humans to drive? We need
weird.
No, yes. I mean, that's a fact. That's a fact. The longer
I was just saying it's a German.
Yeah, you were making a Hitler thing. I'm saying that the longer we allow humans to drive, the more innocent people we murder, and the faster we can get robots in charge, the better. And I think once people see those numbers, things will pivot very, very quickly. It will become increasingly unpopular to sit there and romanticize driving.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, I don't think that we're going to get much argument on that point, you know, on this joke particularly.
Well, and my kind of last thought on this is, in a world where these cars receive over-the-air updates and so much of this is built on software, at what point is software complete? At what point do they stop entering, you know, initial development and it becomes optimizations or patches, bug fixes? Like, when is complete?
Well, and that's the classic question with all software. The only thing different about this question and this situation is the software might kill you. like that. The question is, how much does that fundamentally alter the discussion? You know, because it's one thing to, you know, buy a crappy game for that's incomplete for $60. It's another thing to, you know, have your car not recognize that you're headed towards a semi.
Well, and cars probably, I mean, besides recalls, couldn't exactly get frequent updates, certainly at the clip that Teslas do. So that's also kind of, my guess would be a newer sort of paradigm in the auto industry is updating your car. So
there is more on this. You can read Elon Musk linked Peter Diamandis's blog about it and his exact quote when linking the Fortune story was misunderstanding of what beta means for Tesla, to Tesla for Autopilot. Any system with less than 1 billion miles of real world driving to them is beta. It is not that it is not ready. It is that it has not driven 1 billion miles. So that is his point. He also, weird week for Elon. And believe you me, I mean, we revere Elon Musk as a God made flesh here on this podcast, and we will not stop anytime now. But he was very heated at Fortune specifically this week, and gleefully linked a Reddit AMA with Stephen Gandel, a senior editor at Fortune, who had written about Tesla and Elon Musk specifically when it came to whether or not Elon Musk had not reported the death because it was or was not material to a stock sale that he had. Elon Musk was obviously made personally upset by this and gleefully retweeted an AMA that Gandel did where he did not answer some pointed questions. So follow up. You too can follow the squabbles of Elon Musk if you follow his Twitter.
I will say this in complete, 180 to my attitude up to this point. I don't like Elon Musk should not be getting defensive, and it's not the right time. Like just I mean, after
that
dude
train's
dies.
Left the station, right? Like,
yeah.
Like he's got a trigger fingers turn to Twitter fingers problem, because when he gets upset about something, he is not shy. He's like him and like Mark Cuban. They've got that same like here's the data dump emails that this reporter sent me, and let me create the narrative. And I don't mean that to say that they're fabricating it, but let us shape
the direction of what I mean. It's like there's only one tweet. We should see 85 copies of the same tweet. Such a tragedy. The only acceptable fatalities is zero. Doing our best to get there. Love, EM. I mean, that's... I don't...
It wouldn't be him, right? You know?
No, that's true. That's true.
There is part of it. And obviously, listen, it gives us a talking point here on this show and Andrew abandons us. But like, you know, this is... We get to see the mercurial genius in all of his plumage, right? In petty moments and inglorious. He can have the big... raising his fists in glory when a rocket lands, and he can have every little personal "yeah, but your glasses are stupid" moments with Fortune reporters.
Yeah. Anyway, hey, you know what the only acceptable response to any of this news is?
Brian, would it be going to patreon.com/weirdthings and helping support this very podcast?
Look, man, teach the debate. There's only one way to do that. We're the only people having a responsible debate about whether or not Sasquatch is secretly in love with the Loch Ness monster, and whether or not a robotic Tesla is pleasuring itself watching the two of them hook up. That you will not hear that on anyone else on the lamestream media. And that don't come by itself. We got to pay for producers and for server time and for streaming and so on. So head on over to patreon.com/weirdthings.
Thank you to everybody who has supported us. And we hope to continue to bring you top quality content here at patreon.com/weirdthings.
Yeah.
Man, that video, how artifacty is that video now that I recorded that? My part in the Go Game office, where I no longer work, Brian, your studio was set up
totally differently. Yeah, we've grown so much. This is pre-producer. This is back when I was switching everything myself.
And Andrew,
this is before he got a webcam.
The forever handsome gentleman. I swear, he's going to just look exactly like that at all of our funerals. You too, Bryce. Yeah. You he's just going to be standing over there with his perfect skin, like. What a jerk.
Seems legit.
Well, what's going on, guys?
Oh, okay. This is that weird moment where we have that pause, and I didn't know if you had an angle to go, but I do have an angle to go.
Oh, go, please.
I don't know how to couch this as a scenario, but I had a horrifying moment earlier today. It was in order, things that happened. Justin Robert Young bought a melodica that he had shipped to my house.
That is a true story.
Number two, the
nickel door. Apparently there was a buying instruments for the Brushwood Children's arms race. And yes. I wanted to make sure that I like a good lobbyist, continued to funnel instruments into the Brushwood home.
Second thing that happened was I wanted to explain to the kids why a melodica was awesome/hilarious. So I went to go load the Jurassic Park melodica clip. But then I thought, oh, wait, these kids don't know what Jurassic Park is. So then I went to canistream.it and typed in Jurassic Park. And it turns out, guess what, people? All three of the original Jurassic Park movies are showing right now on Netflix. So I was like, oh my God, best chance to show the kids ever.
Yeah.
So I showed a 12-year-old and an 8-year-old Jurassic Park, and they lasted almost an hour, spending most of it complaining.
Yeah. Aww. So where did you get on the tap out?
The scene with the T-Rex, literally the best scene, the most iconic, the
biggest, most climactic,
powerful scene. Yeah.
After he eats the lawyer, spoiler alert.
Yes. Oh, by the way, is that lawyer Jonathan Pryce? Did I somehow miss this and forget this? The High Sparrow, I think, is the lawyer.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yeah. No, take a look at him. Yeah. Oh my God. It definitely is like all of a sudden a young version of the High Sparrow shows up talking with a overly cheesy American accent and then gets eaten by a T-Rex. And it's the High Sparrow from Game of Thrones. Do
Coupon Day.
So here's the thing. I don't know, because the kids followed the plot, and Penny was kind of into the idea of, you know, like, oh, he's stealing the embryos and is sabotaging the whatevers and blah, blah, blah. But once it became, like, I did not realize how much of Jurassic Park is a monster movie. A full-on, straight-up, not here to teach you a lesson, no grand adventure. We're here to try to scare the living pants off of you, and yet was not marketed that way, is not remembered that way. It is a terrifying monster movie.
It's remembered more as a science fiction film, really, than a horror movie. But like Alien, it is far more a just the creatures in the house horror.
And it's like they just barely... It's weird. It's weird to go back and watch it with fresh eyes, looking at it from, you know, the blank slate of kids. Bryce,
was it that they were scared that they couldn't last, you know, longer than an hour? Or?
No. I mean, they first of all, you know, full disclosure, Penny wanted to watch Kung Fu Panda 3, so the whole first hour I had to hear why we weren't watching. Kung Fu Panda 3.
That's hard, man. You can't. It doesn't matter how good your candidate is. If you're running against a hometown favorite,
I was like, well,
get over.
Yes, I was convinced that Penny would get into the science or whatever, but I guess by modern terms, the whole science of it is fairly cliche as well. I don't know. It's got a very anti-technological message to it. I don't know. I'd hate to say it, but I don't think Jurassic Park aged really well. And I would love for people to watch it with fresh eyes.
Number one, and this is getting a little bit more Night Attack than Weird Things, but like Brian and I's debates over the various incarnations of Jurassic Park is maybe as old as our friendship.
Sure.
You know, I don't know. This is the final frontier, though.
Well, and keep in mind, when I say it hasn't aged well, I don't mean, you know, the computer graphics, the puppetry, all of the special effects actually do really, really well. But I'm saying, like, the way we remember Jurassic Park is not the movie that exists. We are remembering a romanticized, fantasized version of it that highlights essentially 20 minutes of the movie. The majority of the movie is a very weird ass story that none of us have remembered. GGG in the chat asks if we read the book. Of course, I would refer you to our ongoing years long discussion about whether you should read the book or watch the movie first. We've done both.
Can relive that argument by buying our comedy album Night Attack, the first one that we did, the one with the yellow cover. Go ahead and buy it. iTunes and Amazon available now.
I think what I'm saying is
the last track, Jurassic Park. Yeah. 8 minutes of us talking about the book and the movie.
Yeah, well, and you know, whatever. That's all this is neither here nor there. But it kind of opens up the discussion. What other movies do we not remember the way they were intentioned? Like I think of The Exorcist has survived and celebrated for different things. We saw as you mentioned, the Aliens franchise. Alien.
Well, I mean, I would say the ones that tend to be skewed are the ones where we remember certain outsized moments, and we tend to expand that and make them the entire movie. So Jurassic Park, obviously, because it was this special effects marvel as well as a Steven Spielberg in the peak of his powers, you know, movie has great acting performances. We remember these kind of iconic moments and sort of spread them out in our head. But I would say really the ones that we have the worst memory on are ones where there's like a big acting performance that just steals the show. Like, right. I think like people, this might not
like,
be
a like great a few example. Good Men. The majority of A Few Good Men was a really boring, very tedious procedural show. But we all remember the one monologue of Jack Nicholson saying you can't handle the truth and all that.
Sure. Or like, you know, the fact that Beetlejuice doesn't show up in the movie Beetlejuice for the first 30 minutes. Like, you know, we don't think about that. We just think of it as, you know, Michael Keaton's movie because he plays this iconic character when really it's not the main character.
Right. What about you, Bryce? Is there a movie that you came to after the fact and that just you didn't understand, like viewing it from a blank slate meant something very different than what you thought it would?
I don't know that I've had a super strong experience with that, but I know when I was young, the movie that I would always watch is A Nightmare Before Christmas. And I have a feeling that if I went back to that movie nowadays, all of my like obsession with it as a kid would have been about just the way it looked and just it kind of being a musical and not like any sort of
not about the fact that it was a death cult celebrating, looking to invade the territory of Christmas and pervert the meaning of the birth of Christ the Savior.
You know, I'll tell you, the biggest thing that I had wasn't a movie, but it was a book. It was The Great Gatsby. I used to read The Great Gatsby. I loved it in high school, and I'd read it periodically. And then, like, at some point when I was, like, maybe 30 or 31, I reread it again, and I'm like, this is trash. This is not a good book. I liked it. Anyway, yeah, big shots to F. Scott Fitzgerald. I got one more weird thingsy thing, because I feel like we've gotten into super night attacky.
Sure.
But I do want to talk. Bryce did something that I don't understand culturally or entertainment wise.
Oh my God. This is a weird thing. For everybody who is waiting for a scenario, here's a scenario that actually happened and is happening. This is the weirdest thing happening on the planet right now that is an actual thing. Everything else that you think is a weird thing is a made up story. This thing is actually happening though.
Yeah, it's not Pokemon Go. I would have an opinion on Pokemon Go if the app would actually load information once in a while instead of being kind of a garbage app. Fun game, garbage app. I think we can all agree.
Wait, hold on. Time out. What's the platform on Pokemon Go? Is it all smartphone or is it?
Yeah. It's AR where like you walk around in physical space. All of a sudden you see a Pokemon pop up. You tap the Pokemon, and now you get AR of it being somewhere around you, and you just flick Pokeballs at it.
So you don't even actually play the Pokemon battle? You don't use spells that are super effective and so on?
Not really. Like, no. The combat
now, apparently,
is
apparently there's a battle training situation.
I don't like
it. You go to certain places. You can't battle other Pokemon trainers, but you can battle test things. Apparently that's fairly fun.
It's like they're gyms, so it's like Ingress, if you know Google Ingress.
Yeah, okay. Again, Ingress is a unique and fascinating phenomenon. It's just not what I would, it seems very off-brand for Pokemon to do that, but whatever.
Yeah.
Well, whatever it is, man, it is certainly a big, gigantic hit for them.
They're
very well with it. However, that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about Pokemon Go. We are talking about social eating. This is a new new category for Twitch, which has made its name as a video game streaming platform and done very, very well with it. It has then spread into creative streams, which is something, full disclosure, my wife works for Twitch Creative. And now, in their drive to find what people want to stream online, they have opened a new separate realm called social eating, which is apparently huge in Korea. And Bryce, we have had no discussions about this. I haven't talked to Bryce about it. I randomly just saw him on Twitter talking about how he was about to do a social eating stream. Before we get into what you did,
okay,
what interests you in the idea of eating on camera and interacting with people while you are eating.
We'll talk about the specific thing probably in a bit, but there's a weird thing that I wanted to try out. I wanted to have an experience of sharing it with people in some sort of live setting. I've used things like Periscope and Meerkat in the past, but those are very like in the moment. They are on your phone. I'm someone who likes to have like a lot of control over stuff like that. It was either like, oh, I can live tweet it, but then that's, you know, just lost in my timeline, or I have this outlet on Twitch and I can just like have this weird moment of trying out this weird food with people, especially in a moment now where like this is a sort of spotlit avenue for it. I think that's what it boiled down to, is that it was Twitch opening up a door that a lesser service avenue would have been where I take that, you know? Because it's not like I was cooking it. So
you're not cooking, because again, you can cook on Twitch Creative. That's a different thing. This is just for social eating. Yeah. Have you watched social eating streams before you did it?
I've watched one or two, and they are very conversational. You see the food, they talk about it a little bit, they talk about other stuff. Sometimes there are other people. And so in that sense, it's kind of not much different than like a vlog or some sort of like YouTube review, but it's just in stream format, which being live can help offset how kind of long it can be.
So here's what's weird about this to me. I assume this is actually you tell me whether or not you think this is factually
interesting. By the way, Krug or Krug in the chat room says mukbang. Yes, mm-hmm. That is what this is trying to capitalize on, the Korean phenomenon of mukbang, which is social eating.
So here's the weird supernova explosion of Justin TV. Eventually collapses into the I'd say white dwarf, but that would imply that it's not bigger than the supernova itself of Twitch.tv. They figured out Justin TV is like, hey, share stuff, people watching you do things. That's great. Turns out that idea is too general. It wasn't until they launched the Twitch.tv brand that specifically was about video games that it's like, oh wow, people like to know that they're going to get one kind of experience when they go in. They don't know, you know, on Justin TV if somebody's going to be hosting a comedy podcast or attending a political rally or disciplining their kids or whatever. And so Twitch TV made sense because it's like, it's a very simple structure. There are video games. There's an inherent story. There's always conflict. This is a place for people to mesh personality with something that's fairly universally relatable. Then they did the same thing with Creative. Creative, brilliant. Bob Ross. We watched Bob Ross for decades. And yes, of course, let's make that, replicate it, and do Twitch TV. Same thing for cooking. Here's the one thing. Mm-hmm. There is not a segment of the populace that inherently, absolutely abhors seeing food cooked. There's not a segment of the populace that reacts viscerally and angrily when somebody plays a video game. There is that for watching people eat. And I'm having a brave moment right now. I'm going to come out to you guys.
Yeah.
As somebody who suffers from, let me look up the word again, misophonia. Misophonia.
Uh-huh.
I cannot handle mouth sounds. I cannot handle the sound of cotton mouth. I cannot handle my kids. There is a flat rule that is very extraordinarily enforced.
I have been at the Brushwood dinner table, and there is like, you know, singing, there is play acting, there is standing on the chair to make a point. A lot of that, hey, listen, let's call it in the field. Let's just see if it's not disruptive. Let's just let it get it out of their system. There is one thing that even before I notice it, Brian will snap on immediately, and that is Penny, close your mouth.
She's actually gotten much, much better, especially at the dinner table. She's very focused and engaged. But the thing that would drive me nuts is I'd be sitting there typing away, doing stuff on the computer, and the children would idly come wandering into the office, and I wouldn't notice it at first, but all of a sudden I just over my ear is
yeah.
And I lose my mind about it. And I don't understand it. And I'm not going to pretend that I'm right on this. This is a weird, messed up thing in my mind. But I cannot handle it. And I don't know any... It is... I think it is non-consensually intimate. And I hate it.
Okay. Like,
I don't want to know or think or feel what your mouth is doing. I do not. That is a violation of the social contract.
So there's also another vector, which is that now, Brian and I and Bryce, you know, we are professional broadcasters and that we get paid to broadcast. And part of that is that you hear, similar to Brian, that people have an issue with listening to people chew and eat and stuff on the air, right? Mm-hmm. Like that's considered to be unprofessional or rude. Mm-hmm. So we just might be out of this particular field, right? Because obviously, at least in Korea, where this is a proven phenomenon, people very much enjoy watching people eat. You know, this is a plus. Bryce, you are the one who went out and into this brave new world, conducted one of these streams, but earlier today, mm-hmm. Did you learn anything about yourself or your audience?
I definitely, because it's Sunday when we're recording this, so there are certainly like people around, if doing the social eating stream is maybe the second time where I've done a Twitch stream. And solely based on the category of what I'm doing, the social eating,
yeah.
Have I actually like gotten random people to get in the chat room?
Which is part of the brilliance of Twitch in general. If you're not familiar with it, you wind up you tend to get, because you've categorized it into video games or exactly what kind of creative thing you're doing or social eating. There are people that just like watching those streams. They like watching Hearthstone being streamed. They like watching people cook. They like watching people eat. So like they will just follow that, and that's what happened to you. You had random people that were just there to watch somebody eat.
Yeah, and I definitely had you know lots of chat realm regulars who showed up, and there was a really good amount of back and forth of asking questions and responding to different things, and it was surprisingly focused on the food. It's interesting to hear your semi-tangent, Brian.
My reverse ASMR stance.
Well, it was interesting to hear that, because when you were saying that, I was like, well, you know, it's not like I'm chewing with my mouth open or I'm trying to get the sound picked up. But then
you're not doing Foley work of like
you're not calling up Rob Kreckel looking for recommendations.
Yeah.
But then I'm rewatching. We've got the live stream here, and I definitely remember like talking with my mouth full, maybe not necessarily eating, you know, full open on the mic, but like having kind of this immediate thing. I don't know a way to describe it, but it almost didn't even register. Like I felt like when I was doing it, I was trying not to be that thing of doing some sort of ASMR experience. But that was generally pretty in the back of my mind. The chat like element of it is huge, probably bigger than just any random game. Like it's like when I do music streams, where you get a lot of people who will come in and ask very specific questions, and you can engage and interact with them, where if you were playing a video game, you kind of are splitting a little more focus with the game.
Sure. I suspect that there's a whole aspect of this that is not the intimacy thing that I was talking about. I suspect that a big part of it is, you know, we like watching the process of food created, it seems like, you know, nobody shows the finale. The final act is, of course, the food being consumed. And I assume that there's a number, you know, you see all the hard work that goes into a particular dish. And you think, does anybody notice the crispness of the honey apple marinade of the whatever? Mm-hmm. You know, and this is an opportunity to be like, oh, do you experience all these things with familiar objects? So I might have taken a slightly off track, but certainly my weird misophonia has prevented me from ever looking at any of this. Like I just, it just seems like at best I'll hear descriptions of foods that I would normally eat, which to a lot of people is the point of doing it. Sure. But to me is, you know, anyway, and at worst I have to hear, you know, somebody slurping their spaghetti and I would not like that.
Yeah, I mean, J.C. Calhoun has similar first reactions that I did, that, you know, you assume that either it is A, a fetish thing, or B, about seeing people eat weird things or a lot or spicy things. So kind of more in the vein of like, watch people eat ghost peppers or something like that, or take the cinnamon challenge, this like physical kind
I guess that's the weird part is, while I would never want to consume any version of any of this, I actually would have no problem doing it for other people, like performing it. And I mean, was it a good experience, Bryce?
Yeah, I ended up having a good, it was short is one thing, is compared to my other streams. It was something where like, I got about 45 minutes in and I could tell I was kind of winding down and a lot of people had left at that point. But for those 45 minutes, it was pretty high activity compared to something like a game stream or a music stream, which can go on for, you know, hours with sort of a more sustained, lower activity thing.
So, Bryce.
Yeah.
Will you return to the social eating arena?
If I find something half as intriguing as the thing that I ate today, then I would. I had the mac and Cheetos, which, if you watch Weird Things Live, we spent maybe 10 minutes talking about the absurdity of it.
Yeah. What is your one sentence review of the mac and Cheetos?
Surprisingly tastes like mac and cheese. I didn't expect it to taste like mac and cheese, but it tastes like Easy Mac.
I mean, as long as we broke the seal on this, but like, there's, it sounds like there's very little Cheeto aspect to this. It sounds like they just took a mac and cheese fried cheese stick and then figured out a label they could slap on from the Frito-Lay Corporation.
Yeah, like, if anything, maybe they called it mac and Cheetos to explain why it's a little powdery inside.
All right.
But yeah, the Cheeto flavor is not there. It should be like, I don't know. It tastes more like Kraft mac and cheese than a Cheeto.
Where have you gone, Chester Cheetah? A nation turns its lonely eyes to you.
Hey, Justin, I'd hate to drag us backwards, but it seems like you've effectively dodged putting in your own take on this. And I understand that you're
leading.
What do you think?
I think it's weird. And
okay, well, and that's the thing. It's not only is the act weird, mm-hmm. but it is weird to me. And again, maybe you don't want to comment because your wife works for Twitch.tv. But it's like, it's just weird to me that that's what they would pick for the next big thing. They've had big hits with creative, with video games, with food. I just, social eating is so strange.
Well, I mean, listen, there's an audience for this, right? You know, mukbang is a thing. And Open Bayou says mukbang was about people from poor areas of Korea getting to understand what fancy food tastes like. And there is an element to this that I do understand. Ashley does cooking streams that are vegan. And then I, as an omnivore, come in and I eat the vegan cooking and I describe what it is and what it tastes like from my palate, because I also eat meat, right? And sometimes that is favorable, but it creates a better, more fuller and complete picture for her streams, in my opinion, because now you get a little bit of a sense of what it tastes like, right? So there are elements of this I do understand. I don't quite understand building a brand on it, you know, or I don't understand, like, all right, well, you know, it's Taco Tuesdays on my social eating channel. Get ready for the crunch. Like, I don't understand that as a drive. But then again, Brian, there is so much of this big, bountiful, beautiful internet for which I have no plug into, and yet it seems to hum along just fine.
Hey, man, I got a pick.
Yeah, man. What's up?
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Nobody saw it coming except for Bryce, who already wrote it in. There's brief moments of true ESP that happens, and you just witnessed it happening.
You know what's so funny is that I knew it was going to be someone's pick, and I thought it would be Justin because he just binged watched.
Oh, that's great. Okay.
And that's my pick as well. Mr. Robot getting the double pick nod here. Bryce, you have seen it, right?
Yeah, I actually just rewatched it this weekend.
Oh my god, I was at I forget where I was. I was out at some whatever. I saw like I was at a restaurant or whatever, and up in the corner, just out of the corner of my eye, I was like, "Oh, that's Mr. Robot. They're doing marathons. They're showing Mr. Robot." And it made me so happy that something that so accurately represents the heart of current modern day hacker culture, that treats its audience with so much respect for their intelligence and their savviness, you know, that takes a bunch of countercultural positions and doesn't make it a cartoon out of them. Although we may feel differently in the future, I don't know. But for right now, holy cow, does Mr. Robot make me so very, very happy. It's a really, really good show.
I was kind of unprepared for it. You know, I had heard that it was good. I don't want to kind of tread on part of the, you know, there is this kind of big dangling conceit that I think the show handles expertly.
I think it's fine to tip that because it's clear from the very first episode. I watched the very, in fact, in the first 2 minutes of the first episode, he identifies himself
well
as a unreliable narrator and says that your presence as a viewer is part of the experience. And I remember thinking like, oh my god, this feels like Fight Club. And then by the end of the first episode, and again, this is not a spoiler, it's only a spoiler if you haven't watched the first episode, their mission is pretty much to execute exactly the mission from Fight Club. And I'm like, oh my god, this is Fight Club, the TV show. This is amazing.
I mean, right down to playing the Pixies song, you know.
Well, yeah, that comes way down the road. But yes.
I mean, sure. But it does not run from that comp.
Correct.
If anything, I think that it almost embraces it. There's the episode that really kind of brought me into this like next level enjoyment was, I am in general, I'm not a big fan of hallucination episodes or dream episodes. Like, I think that when The Sopranos did it back in the late 90s, when the show was really, really good, it was this kind of artistic flourish just to show that this was not the same procedural on network television. That like this is going to be cinematic. We're going to do cinematic things like waste 10 minutes in this really weird arty dream sequence because that's what we can do. We're HBO, we're a different kind of show. And when it really hurt the program, The Sopranos specifically, you know, when you do two full episodes where you know, Tony for various reasons is in his own fantasy parallel universe, I think that it can be really indulgent and really, really stupid. There is a episode in Mr. Robot that does every element of that with this this Requiem for a Dream kind of sheen on top of it, and it is jaw-dropping. And again, that's another one where it doesn't run from the comp because it has this very Requiem for a Dream sort of feeling, right down to the fact that the television is kind of giving these signals and is kind of playing this Greek chorus. And then Keith David's voice shows up randomly and you're like, yeah, no, they know what they're doing. This is a show that has more control over what it is doing than you think it is. It is smarter than you, and you are thrilled as it unfolds before you.
Yeah, well, and that particular episode serves a purpose in that it added more confusing imagery to throw you off the scent of what they actually wanted to do. So it's like when you remember things, oftentimes you don't remember the situation, but you remember the images of it. And for the coy things that they pull off over the first season of the series, it is very effective and important that even though you don't remember why you saw those set pieces, it's important that you remember you saw those set pieces so that to give maximal impact to where stuff goes.
Dude,
later on.
People are in the chat room saying, oh, I skipped through it or I felt cheated because I was like, what, at the end? Man, rewatch that episode right now because there is no wasted calories. They are all, every element of that is setting stuff up that pays off
later.
In the show. Like, it is brilliant in that while you're like wondering, okay, is this real? Is this not? This is obviously a fantasy. How much of a fantasy is it? At what point did the fantasy start? You're asking yourself all these questions. You become legitimately disoriented into the story, which is kind of the point thematically. Every element, it's all there. It's all there for a reason. Even though it just feels like a big jumbled mush, that all pays off. It is so good.
Yeah, couple of notable performances. First of all, Christian Slater, I think this might be the favorite thing I've ever seen him do in anything ever. And granted, he plays a one-note character, but it is a utterly engaging note. Even going back and watching the first episode for a third or fourth time, I was just like, the brief moments he's in there, I was sucked in. It's
can we just say poutiest lips on television, all of them, like every one of that cast, they just have
all of the wives and girlfriends are pouty, except for maybe I almost gave a spoiler. Except for one of Rami Malek's teams. Yeah. Yes, but certainly by the way, the wife, trying real hard not to be spoilery, the wife of the guy who works for E Corp, there is a scene with her and Rami Malek, only one scene in the entire first season where the two of them meet. And it is electric when you watch it one way. It's even more electric if you go back and watch it again, trying on different scenarios. And this is the genius of the unreliable narrator, is you're like, literally anything could be true. Try on different things. And it just gets more and more interesting. So good.
I mean, they hit you with the part of the twist to the central conceit for which you feel that you have a handle on, and I bought it so hard that I legitimately fully went the opposite direction, and then when they re-reveal it to be another thing or a clarification of the thing, I was also surprised. Man, it's just, it really is just a fully, fully, fully exceptional filmmaking. And I think that, you know, that there's this really, really weird, I think, definable class of shows that are on now. And I would say specifically Fargo, Preacher, and Mr. Robot.
Yes. That is fully self-aware and knows to inoculate you against certain eye-rolling tropes. Like it knows that you know that this is a thing they do, but by mentioning or hinting that they know that you know whatever, it suddenly puts you in a disarmed state to where you can follow along to those big leaps.
But it also kind of feels like this freewheeling, and obviously Fargo is kind of a direct thing because it has the legacy of the Coen brothers, but it almost feels to me like kind of what independent cinema felt, or what we would understand as independent cinema, felt like in like the late 90s. There are these, a lot of these kind of big, wild, crazy stories that go in their own direction and rely on strong characters and strong plotting and strong storytelling, and yet are taking visual chances and are trying to look for their own visual style that just kind of envelops you. Like it is, you know, we've often talked about kind of this like golden age of television that started in the late 90s and has kind of stretched on now for two decades, or two decades plus. But these shows feel like they are put together, right? Like, yeah. Like they just have these big cinematic kind of feels to them. They all have.
And by the way, this is a fun game. If you've already watched Mr. Robot, go back and watch it again. But take a look at and Bryce, because he's a genius, has already called it up, has brought up a bunch of screenshots of the cinematography. They do something that helps to amplify the disjointed, unsettling nature of the show, in that the shot reverse shot is completely wrong. First of all, 2/3 of any given scene is space above the head, and most often two characters, when they're talking, are talking into the corner where you don't see the other person. It feels so wrong the entire time you're watching. It's brilliant. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant.
Also, an amazing performance by BD Wong.
By who?
By BD Wong.
Oh, yes, yes. I don't know if it's a spoiler to give context to that. That's fine.
Yeah, that's full stop. BD Wong is really great in this.
I mean, there is a moment where, you know, you have people that got to make a big impression with not a lot of time, and that is certainly something that happens. The cast is great. You know, here's what I found. I tweeted this in watching it. And to kind of go back to the amazing pouty lips, like, that cast is like, you could just take that cast and put them on some CW show where they're vampires in the Middle Ages, right? Like, and they would all wear bodices and just look amazing and gorgeous together. They are all like really, really, really pretty actors, exceptionally pretty actors.
Well, and yet through like a concerted effort, they make them all look flawed and unpretty, right?
Like trash, yeah. Right? Like Clint Eastwood in the desert in Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Like, especially you know, Rami,
Rami Malek, yeah,
yeah, Rami Malek, the Elliot who plays Elliot in the main character. Like, man, that dude. Any other show, he could be an action hero. He could be in a Marvel movie, and he would be, you know, the big smile and wink kind of handsome guy. He looks every inch of kind of the weird character.
Just the weirdo. I mean, he perfectly. I mean, it's almost as though we all know that guy. By the way, for those of you guys wondering why we spent 20 minutes talking about Mr. Robot, is because it premieres with season 2 this week on the 13th on USA Network. And I don't know if you know this, Justin, but all of the episodes for the second season directed by the creator, Sam Esmail. He only did one or two episodes of the first season. He's doing all of them of the second season.
He's writing them all, too.
Oh, that's right. Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
I was very curious to read more about him. And that might be another element of this, is that maybe part of this generation of television is now that we have kind of canonized the showrunner in a way that we never really did before in television, right, and made them the brilliant god geniuses. You see them have more power and with that more prestige, down to the fact that in this particular show, you have the creator's name as if he was, you know, Quentin Tarantino on the front of every single episode. This is very much, you know, where TV traditionally is, you know, takes a village to make a child. There's a writer's room. Even if somebody writes, you know, a writer will write the script, and the showrunner will probably rewrite a fair amount of it, but yet the original writer gets the credit. This dude, like, maybe that's something
baby
that further makes it feel cinematic, is because, like a movie, and that takes a lot of people too, it is the director's film, right? You know, they are prestige directors. And this, to me, feels like a prestige showrunner show in the way that a Darren Aronofsky or a David Fincher would have put their mark on something in the late 90s.
Well, and that's one of those two-way streets, right? Where it's like, on the one hand, that is cultural bandwidth that the network hands a singular person to be like, we're going to let everyone know that this is your thing, which of course is, you know, great, has great, cultural value for getting ahead. But on the flip side, it also makes them personally responsible for it if it's not good. Like, it also shifts responsibility if this is too weird for
this
space.
Oh, listen, and by the way, if Mr. Robot Season 2 disappears up its own butt and in its pretensions and you know, becomes obsessed with giving us too many turns and not enough resolutions, he will be the one who gets blamed.
Correct, mm-hmm. Correct.
That will in fact be the case. I certainly hope not. You know, the reviews on the first episode that debuts this week are excellent. You know, it's one of those things where, man, and maybe we can have a spoiler discussion on this, but like there are times, especially binge watching it, man, like I became more paranoid. Like I became doubting what I was watching and what I wasn't watching. Like it is a paranoia festival. And by the end of it, as characters start to talk to each other and you're like, wait, do they know each other? Like, why are they talking to each other? Wait, why is, like, you know, now this person has this opportunity. Is that a trap or is that just a thing? Like, now you start to feel like Elliot seeing Men in Black on the street. Like, yeah. You are paranoid about the decisions that the characters are making in a way that's kind of rare for television. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Robot, that's my pick. What's yours?
I think we all did Mr. Robot. That was a triple shot, Mr. Robot, unless Bryce, you had something else?
I do have something that I want to share because I've been in love with it for maybe the past 3 months and I keep watching it over and over again. It's a series on Polygon called Monster Factory.
Okay, now, if I remember correctly, you explained this to me as it's a video series where literally it's two charismatic individuals doing nothing but doing character creation screens, trying to make them as hideous as possible and yes. Laughing about it.
Yes, so they will go into video games and, like, if you're watching the live video, they've got Fallout 4, and they're just making this ghostly face. They skip ahead and they make Trash Hulk, who is sort of a shabby-looking man with a bloody face, and Hulk Hogan's hair. And so
it's pretty amazing, actually. I already love this.
And so it's Griffin and Justin McElroy, who you might know from My Brother and Me, the podcast. And they go in and they make these nasty characters, and then they play the game as them, and they characterize them, and they're great. They're like by all accounts, it is a video that is that ought to be too long. Like they're usually a half hour or so,
mm-hmm.
But they're so funny and so into the concept. Like there's no pretense of like, we're, you know, gonna try to be funny. Like they are fully into this. And it's
for the audio listeners, we're watching video of them going around and stealing the clothes off of all the other members of the vault.
Yeah, so they did a three-part Fallout 4 saga with the final Pam trying to break the game from the inside, and they succeed.
Oh, that's great.
And I think if you know the film critic Hulk,
sure. The guy who writes
movie reviews and stuff in all caps and stuff,
right?
Kind of as Hulk, he called it like the funniest piece of television ever made, or something like that. Like the funniest thing on the planet, which maybe is I don't know. It's YouTube knows that I like to watch this, and it recommends it to me constantly because I will just rewatch these. So if Mr. Robot is a little too serious, check out Monster Factory. That's on Polygon. Polygon.com or YouTube.com.
That is amazing. Well, Brian, any final words?
Man, I feel like the only thing we denied the listeners was some kind of scenario. We'll just have to come back and be in the moment a little more hardcore next week. I felt like we got a little bit silly, but it was a lot of fun.
Bryce, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter, @BryCas, BryCas. And check out my new music thing. It's a music playlist project, so if you like cool new music,
This is great, by the way, because if you're a listener or watcher of DiamondClub.tv, you oftentimes hear awesome selections for the pre-show, post-show music. Bryce, turns out that listening to a lot of music and making music makes you pretty good at picking good music. Really good music.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I got Apple Music and then was like, oh, streaming music is very cool. There's a lot of stuff here.
Oh, hell yeah.
So I had this idea to do a email newsletter / playlist thing. So every couple of weeks, I send out people an Apple Music and Spotify link.
Oh, wait. I can sign up for your mailing list?
Yeah, where do I go?
Yeah, so you go to thatsounds.cool is the actual URL.
What?
And so you can see, you know, previous email lists. They have...
subscribe to email list.
Yeah, there's a subscribe to email list button. And, you know, I pull out some particular releases in that playlist that I like, and I talk about them a little bit. And it goes straight to your email, and it comes out every couple of weeks or so. I really think it's cool. I think we've got... I'm surprised at how many people are subscribed.
Dude. Well, I mean, yeah, nutty thing. Turns out when you put out reliable, good content... people respond. Yeah. Who knew?
Well, and what makes me really happy about it is that it's the transaction doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
Like when you get it, I'm not selling you on anything anymore.
Yeah, sure.
You can click this link if you'd like it.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
Which is something I'm really happy about, cuz it doesn't feel like a, you know, future revenue stream. It feels like a hobby.
No, it's a fun project. Neshcom, you are indeed the Beshcom. And as for us, folks, it's been weird.
Keep it weird.
Wing ding diddly ding dong do. We do the weird things. What about you?
Cool. Very cool. So I sent Andrew a couple of emails today. Before I knew he wasn't going to be on. So we do have... I'll send this to you guys, and you guys make a call on it, because I'm not 100% on him.
Here, let me just take a look.
Oh, well, then I'll send it to Justin. In the meantime, I'm going to take a look at some show titles. Oops, that's not what I wanted to open up.
Yeah, I kind of want to explore this whole music email list curation thing.
Sure.
Because I think that's an emerging space.
I'm into that. Oh, we didn't reset Showbot before the show, but some good ones. Eating things.
Yeah.
Love EM. Failure is not an opt-in beta. Okay, it's clever. I think some of these are politics titles.
Dude, Perfect, hey, Justin.
Yeah.
Preacher tonight.
Are we getting to the end of the season? Or
no, I think we're just over halfway. I think we have three or four more. No, it was 10 episodes, right?
10 episodes this season.
Yeah. We got to be around 6 or 7, right?
Let's check cordkillers.com. See if that has. We're at number 7 tonight.
Wow. Okay.
I'm all in on preacher.
Dude, it's great. It is great. Can I say flatly just what I've seen so far of this season of Preacher? And this is not nothing, but this is a better season. Preacher season 1 is better than Game of Thrones season 7 or whatever we were just watching. Wow. Like, there were great payoff moments, but there was a lot of dicking around. Like, it just feels so rich, so fast. I'm really excited.
Man, maybe this is why Court Killers is so successful, because that is definitely like a, you are better at me. When we did Hotline Monday, the idea was to like get people riled up and call. Like, that is a better hot take than I would come up with. Like,
all of a sudden you just see everybody rise up on one side or the other. You're like, yes, fight!
Because I mean, to me, those are like, you know, two totally different, like, issues, right? Like, I mean, like Preacher is, I mean, I would comp Preacher to season one or season two of Game of Thrones before I would comp it to season seven. But of course,
season seven though is, and you know, my response would be that season seven it was exciting and fun only for the payoffs that were established before it. Was there anything new that we got? Everything was just like, ha ha, I knew it would turn out that way. Or, ho ho, I didn't expect it to turn out that way. Everything, like, and that's not to say, you know, you don't have to go full George R. R. Martin and keep setting up, you know, more tangents to where you get fatigue. But you can be in your seventh season and still be setting up new stuff. They set up nothing. But it was all payoff.
Game of Thrones is clearly on the downswing. Like,
that doesn't matter. I mean, there's shit collapse that comes out in the third act of, you know, Terminator movies that I love. You know, it's like, you know, they could still be setting up new stuff and revealing more threads that get me engaged. They could be still setting up more questions, and they're not.
I mean, I think we've set up more questions. We've set up more questions as to the relationship between Sansa and Jon. We've set up new questions as to, you know, this new alliance that is moving toward King's Landing. We have set up new questions on whether or not, you know, there's really even going to need to be a sack of King's Landing. You know, it kind of threw us this okey-doke of assuming that we had moved into this new realm of government, right? And then kind of ripped that back off the table for us. So I don't quite see eye to eye with you on this season of Game of Thrones. But let's put that aside. I think I can't remember a show that so wildly introduced itself so boldly as Preacher has. Like, that there is just like, I mean, there are shows that are great. There are shows that are intricate, like Mr. Robot, like where you go back and you're like, oh my God, what an amazing origami puzzle box this is. And when it, you know, when it seems to be wild, it might actually be, you know, this like Legend of the Drunken Master. Like, you know, there still is no wasted movement, even when you think that it's out of control, kind of thing. Where Preacher, the point is that it's out of control. Like, the point, and if anything, what I've been happy with as it's gone on is, like, it almost hit that button a little too hard in the first few episodes where it's, like, every conversation at every gas station and diner is going to eventually get back to a child murder or sexual assault. Like, you know, where it's, like, some big, long, like, yeah, found the underwear stuffed in their mouths. Like, as the slow camera like pans in on somebody, and it's like they've eased off that a little bit, where it's like, okay, we get it, you guys will go anywhere, everyone is going to be, the bad people are going to be worse than anyone has ever existed, you know, the passive violence and abuse of power will be disgusting and will make us recoil, like, we get it. And I think, I don't know, I mean, it's amazing, it's fantastic. I don't know I would go so far as to say it has made me realize that other stuff is less good, but I could not be higher on Preacher personally.
Do we have an angle of what we want to do on After
Yeah,
things?
We got two emails here.
Okay, all right, here, I'm going to run to the restroom, and then we're going to rock this.
You like both of those, Justin?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Hey, it's like I can make him into something.
Cool, cool, cool.
It is funny that people send like that this one is addressed to me.
Yeah, you sent me that one like almost 2 weeks ago, actually.
Oh, I sent that to you.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
And it was sent to somebody else.
Sent
to me.
So it was sent to you, and then you sent it to me, and now I've sent it back to you to complete the buck passing. You know when you burp and you get a flavor of what you've eaten? I just had that with a yawn.
Really?
Yeah, I just yawned and tasted the Easy Mac.
But that's a stealth burp.
Is it?
A yawn is a polite burp. A yawn is a sleepy burp.
The king's burp.
The king's burp.
Ugh.
Yeah, we found out Yara F's the T's off, ladies.
Yeah.
That was a new thing.
Yeah. Hitting on Danny.
Mm-hmm. Hey, listen, man, that's a long ride.
Yeah.
Long ride to Westeros from Meereen.
I watched that The Night Of pilot.
Yeah, raves about that.
I think it was pretty good. My only thing getting away from that episode was it's hard. I'm not trying. It feels weird to try to avoid spoilers on the first episode of something. But I came away from that thinking, well, there's no possible way that he's innocent. Like there wasn't any point in the episode that was like, hey, like, here's a contradiction. It was just like, hope you like get an emotional bond with this guy, because we're kind of gonna put him up against some walls and nails.
The people who have seen more than one episode of it are, you know, jump up and down and rave. It's apparently really, really well done. The story's great, and it like just got all of the New York actors. Like, they're just all of them are there. Mm. Like, you know, everybody that you've ever seen as like a bit part in anything else, especially in like the HBO family. Mm-hmm. Like, they're all just doing great work.
Like
The night before or whatever.
The guy from Veep was in there for like a half a scene. I don't remember his name, but
by the way, I finally finished up this season of Veep. Curious to see where they go from there.
Yeah. I liked that second to last episode where it was Catherine's
documentary.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I thought it was great. I love Veep. Mostly because I love insults. And nobody does insults on television like
Julie Louis Dreyfus.
They in fact, so they have it. Do you watch Veep, Brian?
I've seen most of the first season. Or all of the first season, part of the second one. Say again.
They introduce a character in this one that's literally just there to be the kind of like raging, insulting id of like, he does not open his mouth unless he's like yelling some like horrifyingly profane, weird, like, you know, line or
he's insult. Like an Ari Gold proto.
I mean, imagine if there was no story. Ari didn't have a wife. Ari didn't have a business. Ari didn't have clients. It was just the like, just Ari on the phone doing the like hard ass, like, I'll do this or you're fucking dead.
Yeah. Sure.
But it's just it's this dude who's helping this weirdo get elected in New Hampshire, and he just is like, as he watches his creation kind of come to full fruition, just is like next to some random woman that we've never met before saying like, I could get a Muslim strain of AIDS elected the governor of New Hampshire. Just a Muslim with the tiniest little suicide vest strain of AIDS. And it's just like a stranger next to him, just like, you're drunk. We get it. Just stop.
That's amazing.
All right. You guys ready to do this?
Yep. Yeah. Yep.
All right. Take it away again. 3, 2.
Welcome to After Things. It's a show that we do after weird things. We talk about business. We talk about creativity. We talk about how you can take your dreams from the nascent ideas that lay between your ears to actual full-fledged reality. Joining me, as always, is Andrew Main.
I'm Andrew Main. Not really. I'm Brian.
And Brian Brushwood.
Hey, no, I'm actually Brian Brushwood.
And Bryce Neshcom Castillo.
Hey, how's it going?
Got a couple emails. Yeah. This one comes in from Cole. Cole writes, I'm a co-host of a new show called Geek Street Cafe. I know you might not have time to read as many of these as I'm sure you get, but please, I'm begging you to take a moment. My friend and I have been longtime supporters of Weird Things ever since we found it several years ago. We have finally decided to move into the entertainment business as well. and have been reaching out to others that might find it interesting. We intend to create an online talk show that will revolve around geek culture and its wonderful content and make it uncomplicated and as likable as possible. I know this sounds like a pitch, but I was really hoping you could just take a look at our Kickstarter page and our Facebook page and just get back to me with what you think. So that would be Geek Street Cafe, a new kind of tech talk. That is their Kickstarter. And their Facebook is facebook.com/Geek Street Cafe. Two handsome young gents doing the show. Here's what I would like, the position that I would like to take on this is something that I hear a lot with people who do podcasts on, you know, how do we do something that is in a crowded space? Like, there's obviously no shortage of outlets to talk about geek and geek culture, be it labeled specifically that or just in other shows that wind up delving in to this. I mean, like, how many, I think every podcast that ever was made, whether or not they were about personal finance, politics, or art, did a review for The Force Awakens, right? Brian, what do you think? You're getting into someplace that is obviously very crowded. How do you differentiate yourself? How do you find an audience?
That's a good question. Here's to tie it in to this week's episode of Weird Things. I do think it's curious. So let's say total blank slate. You have a daily show where you're going to talk about geek things. And of course, there's plenty to talk about every single day, right? IO9 and the blog space has made a name for itself. There's a number of different ways to do it. The Geek and Sundry Network is a lifestyle channel dedicated to that space. Here's what I don't know for sure is whether or not YouTube is the right vehicle for that. I think that in general, YouTube is something that commands your full attention on both the visual and the audio spectrum. I wonder, and it's curious to me why Twitch doesn't have any kind of content. In a world where Twitch.tv has a vertical for consuming actual food, I can't believe that they don't have a vertical for consuming content. In a world where Talking Dead, Talking Saul, all of these posts, you just watched a show, let's talk about the show, things exist. I can't believe Twitch TV doesn't have a vertical that caters itself to that. If it did, I would say that would be the best place for this. Absent that, a second place would be, I would think more of a podcast angle would go because people can do other things while they listen to it. If it is going to be on YouTube, that's difficult because you either need to distinguish yourself with highly poignant pop culture, scathing indictments of X, Y, or Z. You know, you could be a Mikey Loves Movies or I forget the other one. Your movie sucks, or a Red Letter Media. But it's not knowing anything about the content. If it's just I saw this thing and I liked it, you're right, Justin. It's going to be really, really difficult to set yourself apart. But in fact, let me kick it over to Bryce. You probably have a different perspective on all this than me.
I would say a live streaming element over some sort of produced YouTube video would be just in a bunch of different ways easier to start out in, easier to maintain constantly. You kind of get into this weird thing of content content rights on both sides of the equation, but
which I know is a concern of yours, since yeah. You're the one like we can wave our hands and say play the thing, and you're the one who thinks tomorrow Bryce is not going to be thrilled yeah. when it takes four uploads and I have to reverse the video and pixelate it and makes it small in order to get it on there.
And then eventually I just have to cut the video out anyway because right, content right. ID is so sophisticated. So that's kind of a tough thing.
And continues to get better. Like we just got our probably the most sticky pre-show moment that we might have ever had was when I was stuck in traffic on the way to do a show in Los Angeles, do a Night Attack show. It might have been NSFW still, actually.
Yeah, it was.
And went on this big tirade that involved Brian playing copyrighted music, and that just got pulled down this week. Like, that's been up for years on YouTube.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, just got yanked. So there is, and I have no idea, but I do suspect that might be part of the reason why, you know, Twitch might not want to promote that more. Is just they don't want to get into content ID situations. Kerfuffles.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because for live, content ID is a different beast, right? Like, content ID is like,
it kind of works
streaming pay-per-views. Like, you're streaming the UFC card, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's smart enough to be like, hey, I think you're using music. You should stop it. But, you know, that's part of what the YouTube delay is, to actually run it through a basic content ID filter. But that's just one element of this. I'm looking at their Kickstarter, and you know, they say they want to do email and Reddit, Twitter and Facebook avenues to do videos and reviews. Just looking at this Kickstarter specifically, I feel like this is a little vague, a little ambiguous almost on what exactly the output is. So as someone who they would be trying to target, that's one thing, just logistically, of like, there's not enough information here on what you need this money for or what will come out of this exactly. But in terms of like making your name in this space, it's about, to me, from a bigger picture sort of view, it is about like finding other people who are just as small as you and hustling your way to, you know, getting every single fan and trying to be in front of a bunch of different people, especially when you have kind of a general focus on that's
actually a really good point. Is the counterintuitive truth is that intuitively it seems like the more broad your appeal is, the more broad the thing, your widget, your product, your show will cover, the more people it will appear to. And it turns out that it's the exact reverse. Mm-hmm. The market rewards extraordinarily specific things. Now, once you've built your audience, you can maybe expand into other things. But the best thing that ever happened to Scam School was on the flight out to shoot the pilot. I was trying to figure out, hey man, show's gonna start and there's something I have to say that is vaguely related to tech because we're on a tech, you know, online network or whatever. And so, and you know, it was on the flight out there that the phrase, the show dedicated to social engineering at the bar and on the street, was a very specific, very accurate phrase that tied into, satisfied everything, and it made this puzzle piece. It also defined the nature of the show for the next 8 years, right? And yeah. Similar, we did the same thing with, I guess, as we've moved into Night Attack, we finally figured out that we would call it the show bringing you the best of the worst of the internet, you know, and that's very much been a very specific thing. Now, you know, and around that, we're able to put in a bunch of personal stuff. But in the question of, do I want to invest my time to watch this thing? Well, what is it? The clarity of your message matters.
So let's dwell a little bit on the idea of a Kickstarter to launch something. Everybody here has run a successful Kickstarter that has launched things, different things. I made a card game. I've also launched one for a podcast for FSL. Bryce has done an album. Brian, you ran a crowdfunding to start scamstuff.com.
Online business, yeah.
Mm-hmm. A business.
Which, by the way, of all of us, like, at least all of yours were creative endeavors. Mine's like, hey, let me build a building so I could sell stuff to you later.
Yeah. But effectively, you did a pre-sale.
Correct.
That was just an extraordinarily smart and clever way to say, hey, look, if I can do this in a pre-sale, I have a business.
Yeah.
So would you like to step into my store?
Yeah, and turns out the answer was, yeah, I guess.
The answer, well, no, it was a resounding, life-changing yes, right?
Yes, yes, it was.
So I don't know how smart launching a new show is when you don't have an existing audience. And I don't know how much of an audience Cole and Charles have coming into this, but I, with Tom, we would not have launched FSL as a Kickstarter if we didn't have previous audiences.
Right. You two would not have launched a Kickstarter saying like, hey, we have an idea for a crazy, outrageous show where it's mainly puns and inside references, but it'll kind of be fantasy sports, but it'll be largely modeled on sports talk radio. Blah, 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 blah. I guess what you're getting at, Justin, is something we've talked about before, is that in general, you got to do the thing first and yeah, then figure out a way to make money. Mm-hmm. Do the thing, figure out if people like the thing, then figure out a way to get paid doing the thing that people seem to like.
You got to plant the seeds and then harvest, right? Like you got to get the momentum and then take advantage of it and then find out a way to use it. But you got to heat that up first, because to just kind of go right to go, especially if the goal is like $5,000. I mean, here's my, you should not be launching a Kickstarter that you don't genuinely believe will go at least two times what you're asking.
Correct. And for comparison, when I launched scamstuff.com, I did it after 6 years or 5 years of Scam School being on the air. My ask was $10,000 of pre-sales for actual projects. So at that by that point, Scam School was doing over 1 million views a month. And at 1 million views a month on YouTube, I was able to ask for $10,000 of pre-orders. And we did well. We did, you know, we got $33,000 of pre-orders, which, by the way, ended up, that's the other thing. Get ready for everything to cost more than you think it does. Yeah. but that's neither here nor there. So understand that an ask of $5,000 is half of what I asked after 6 years of pre-work going into Scam School.
Well, you know, there's a lot that kind of goes into thinking of a Kickstarter. Like, and without getting into specifics, there are people that have been around us that have launched Kickstarters that are unprepared and aren't ready for prime time. And like, this is not, Kickstarter's not where magic happens. That's the narrative, right? Is like,
oh, I had an idea and I pitched it to the world and the world said yes, and now the idea has happened. By the way, I got a scary, scary realization for you guys. What happens? You want a case study in what happens when you pitch a magical idea to the world and the world delivers? You end up the peach printer. Have we talked about this on this yet?
Oh, boy.
Oh, good. Peachy printer. Good gravy. I don't know if we've talked about it on this, but real quick, let's get into the ultimate Kickstarter horror story.
So the peachy printer is a brilliant, brilliant idea. It's a thin picture a cylinder that plugs into your mic and your earbuds or earphone thing on your laptop. Software tells it add one drop of salt water once at a time. A laser flashes on a thin sheen of resin, and it essentially, you know, it takes a long, long time, but it eventually rises the salt water and the resin locks everything in, and you actually have a 3D printer for less than $100. Brilliant, very clever, you know, considering that last week my pick was a beautiful constraint. The fact that that somebody, you know, had the constraint of how do you make a 3D printer for under $100, came up with a brilliant method, was unprepared for what happened. It raised just over $500,000. And last month, he had to release a video. A
couple months back, yeah.
where he admitted that his business guy, his finance guy, essentially embezzled 2/3 of the money.
To build a house.
To build a house.
Sure.
That's an example of a bad business partner. It seems that person, you know, went above and beyond, unless there's more to the story that we don't know.
We could picture this on a smaller scale. Let's say you and I had a Kickstarter and we didn't expect it to do that great. And we wanted $500, but instead we got $2,000. But it was set up to, you know, where it went into one of our accounts. And then one of us figured like, this thing's blowing up. It's clearly going to do well. In the meantime, I don't have the money to cover this. I'll just do it. And then we'll replace it later. And then that's, of course, how whoopsie embezzlement happens. Is down the road, it's like, hey man, where's that money? And you're like, oh, it's coming.
Yeah, no. I mean, there's a million. I mean, so like, all right, there's a couple lessons here, right? There is how to do a successful Kickstarter, and then what you're like, you've done a successful Kickstarter. Now here are the million different pitfalls that you can fall into, and they are kind of two separate conversations. I would say to Geek Street Cafe, to Cole and Charles, think about whether or not you want this to run its full course. Like that you might want to, that might be what you want to do. And that's fine. I wouldn't blame you either way. But I don't know whether or not it would be in your best interest to not say, hey, look, for everybody who was interested in it, thank you. We're just going to start rolling right now and doing whatever we can. And then once you have a little bit of an audience, make it specific what you are doing. Like, you are not looking for $5,000 to start a YouTube show or a podcast. You are building the Geek Street Studio, right? And you are speccing out and you are letting people know exactly what you're doing, and you're letting people know that with this studio, we will now, in addition to what we already create, be able to create the following different things, right? Now, this is not an easy thing to do. It's hard to figure out what your audience wants and how you can entice them to help support you monetarily.
By the way, keep in mind that we're not even discussing whether or not you deserve $5,000. That's a fact. You deserve $5,000. The question is, do you want to stand there and say, well, let me get the $5,000 and then I'll start? Or do you want to start doing it because you love it and because you want to explore this part of yourself and figure out the story that you have to tell? And then 6, 8, 10 months, a year, whatever, say, hey, by the way, we want to take this to the next level. Can we please have $5,000? Because the donation train is real. Like, that's a real thing. And you can see live on the air back in the BB live show days, before there was Night Attack, before NSFW, when all of my stuff broke live on the air and frustrated, I just threw up my hands. I was like, I don't know, guys, this computer's, I'm doing my best, but I don't have the equipment. And it was magic when $500 appeared. It was the most shocking, astonishing. What's that?
In your PayPal.
In my PayPal account. So please don't take anything we're saying as you can't get the money. The answer is yes, absolutely you could get the money. The question we have is Kickstarter, is demanding the money before you start the best business strategy? And I think I can't say whether or not it'll work or not work, but I'll say for sure that's not how I've done it. That's not how Justin's done it. And although it does sound like that's how Bryce did it.
with my Kickstarter?
Yeah. No. Or I guess you already had it, or you?
I had a very small ask on my Kickstarter. I only asked for like $1,000.
And that was specifically to finish this CD. So at that point, you had stuff to show. Yeah. Got it.
And I was aware I had a very, very tiny following. I mean, I think I only ended up clearing like $1,100 or $1,200. Mm-hmm. So, but if I went to Kickstarter beforehand or a year ahead of even making the album, I probably would not have had the right number in my head. I probably would have been like, oh, you know, the Night Attack guys kind of know me a little bit. I got this great idea. I'm going to need some money to whatever, take time off or do this thing. And the number would have been wrong.
Right.
Just like almost assuredly. And there would have been a risk of just like getting money and not knowing on either end what was going to come out. So in that sense, I made it really clear and really clear on the campaign that like this thing is done. I am looking for like this last push to like get it out to you ASAP.
Right.
And you know, you had already done remixes for us, mm-hmm. right? On albums. You were somebody that was known within our community. You had previously done other original music. Mm-hmm. There was a lot there already, and you were asking for a very reasonable amount of money. You're asking for $1,000. And effectively, again, a lot of that's already pre-sale, right? Because that's $1,000 that is like, no, buy a CD. Buy a CD or a t-shirt, which I think I got both, despite the fact that
you said don't send me a reward. I always do that. Yeah. Hey, real quick, to be fair, have we taken a look? Like, do they have a bunch of sample episodes or anything on there?
They've got their campaign video, but it doesn't. I think they're kind of got just a Facebook
so this thing. This is not we want to monetize an existing show. It does say we want to create a YouTube daily show.
Right.
You know, that's fine. And if your game plan is to really just, you know, ask all your friends for a buck or two, this is a good way. And if that's what it takes to jumpstart your creative thing, go for it. But I'm going to say that in general, here's the downside is once you accept money for a thing, you are bound to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You have to do it forever. You will. And I am thankful to express that this has not happened on any of the shows that we collect money for, but I have understood the perils and challenges that come with the fact that, well, now we're getting paid. That means that blowing it off. And we talked about this for Weird Things. Weird Things was always a for fun thing, which meant it got done half the time and at an erratic schedule. And ended with to the tune of $400 an episode. We each get like $100, and then all of a sudden it becomes like, no, I'm sorry, I can't attend this wedding because I have to go talk about Sasquatch. It becomes
normally by and large we would cancel episodes where Andrew wasn't there because you can replace me, you can replace you, and ultimately Andrew is kind of the heart of the show. But sure. If Andrew can't do it, we still got to do it. It's still a thing. And we got to do after things, right? Like that's just what we are doing because we are getting paid for it.
With Patreon, having the option to do per creation versus per month.
Yeah.
Is like, if for whatever reason, Weird Thing stops, like people are no longer on the hook for this thing, which will just, the wheels will stop. Like if there have been a very few times where we've just skipped a week, and we haven't.
Fine. We're like, okay, that's $500 we won't make this week,
right?
And that's fine.
But now let me also just delve into one very specific 3-word phrase: YouTube daily show.
Oh boy,
God.
Those are 3 words that are far more easily spoken than executed.
Yeah.
Here's all I would say. All right, if I'm going to be totally honest, if I'm going to be keeping it totally 100, here's what I'm going to tell you guys. Pull down the Kickstarter for this reason. Not because it's not a good idea, not because you don't deserve the money, not because you couldn't put the money to good use. Here's why. You need to prove to yourself that you can do a YouTube daily show.
And by the way, doing a YouTube daily show is something I would wish on exactly donut people. That's, and by which I mean people made of donuts. People they're a bizarre monstrosity. No, I mean, it's like, no.
Play catch, and the ball would go right through their midsection.
You have no idea what those words mean. Take it from somebody who does a weekly, I don't know, what 3 weekly YouTube shows?
4 now.
Four weekly YouTube shows. Mm-hmm. It takes we're barely able to make that happen
with two
dedicated hosts, two dedicated full time producer editors, mm-hmm. And we could barely keep that up. It's like.
You know what I would recommend? I did this in college for a little while. I wanted to start doing podcasts, and so this was right when Google Plus blew up,
mm-hmm.
and so I had like 100,000 people following me on Google Plus because just everyone was following everyone.
Sure, sure.
There was someone who would end up being a friend who asked, "Hey, does anyone else want to do a podcast?" Because at the time, Twit and stuff. And so we ended up doing a 4-time-a-week audio podcast, also live. Podcast. I mean,
yeah.
4 times a week we would get on a stream and do all of the technical stuff of trying to figure out how to get online. Then try to be funny or interesting for an hour or so. And then the actual like work of putting that thing together and putting it out. And in that sense, like that is a fraction of the workload of doing a YouTube daily show. I would say as a basic litmus test, like you should consider some sort of gauntlet like that. That doesn't necessarily have to be this thing, but can.
Well, and also here, let me just say this. Hey, Brian.
Hey.
You are at the beginning of your career, but you know what you know in terms of how much work it takes to make a YouTube series.
Sure.
Right? Would you take a one-time lump sum payment of $5,000 to commit yourself to a 6-month stint doing a daily YouTube show?
Well, I'm just going to assume that you mean just the hosting part, right? I don't have to do the shooting, the production, the writing, the editing, or any of that stuff, right?
You have to do that every
day. Oh, I have to do all of that.
5 days a week. You don't have to do it on weekends.
Yeah, but I can only do it like when something interesting is happening, right? I don't have to do it every single day.
No, you have to do it every day.
Even when you get sick or...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay,
oh,
but
yeah,
at least... Yeah. Okay, I hear where you're going. Sure. At least you're saying I get that whole $5,000. I can make that $5,000 last me personally for 6 months straight. I don't have to split it with no one.
Well, now you got to make coffee mugs. You got to make posters. You got to make T-shirts.
Yeah, but I don't have no co-host. It's just me.
Oh, no, right? No. You have a co-host. You don't have a co-host. And also, yeah, I mean, so if you are doing swag here...
So,
then, you definitely have to...
$500, and I got to make stuff to pay out, and then I have to actually do the thing I set out to do.
And a behind-the-scenes blog.
And an extra blog!
And you have to deal...
Guys, okay.
Because you've never done it before.
Okay,
right?
Look. I can't believe I'm doing this. I feel terrible. I don't want to be a dream crusher, a dream killer, but... All I know is only 3 people have backed this project, and it's not too late to rethink all of this. Just call those 3 people and say, "Hey,
Let me just say this. Like, and this is, it's gonna come off weird because all of us have had successful Kickstarters, right? And so it's going to make us seem callous or strange.
Also, what we really are afraid is that you'll take away. Because a lot of people don't know this, but the more other people who are successful, Kickstarter actually takes back money. So it's important that we stop other people from having Kickstarters. Yeah.
Canceling your Kickstarter isn't a loss. Things get moved back all the time. You know, what was that? No Man's Sky, that pushed back.
Like, yeah, finally released.
You know, and now it's coming out. There is no shame in saying this isn't going to happen within a month. We've had new ideas. We've got better things. We are confident creators, and we believe the best product for you is not going to happen within the next few days. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. And anybody that's backed you now will be there the next time. You know, there's, again, this isn't about whether or not you're good. this isn't about whether or not you deserve it. It's let's launch in the best way possible. Because when you ask people for money, especially on Kickstarter, you need to demonstrate that it will get done. That's the number one fear with Kickstarter. And if you're launching a daily YouTube show and you're not already doing a daily YouTube show, I'll just let you know, I've got worries backing it.
All right, so
I know how hard that is.
Time out. Now that we've crushed dreams, let's rebuild, okay?
Let's rebuild.
What you want to do?
Rebuild.
Here's what you can do. Here's what you can do today. You can, in fact, keep that exact. Keep everything about the Kickstarter the same. Keep the money that people have pledged. Do this. Think about an MVP, a minimum viable product. How much money would it take for you to make something tomorrow? If not tomorrow, the next day. And instead, like, restructure. Say, you know what? We looked at this. We're not asking you to launch a network. We're not asking you to launch a show. We need a webcam. We need two mics. And we need this one editing software. It's $500. We can get you something for $500. And that's what we're framing all this as of today. We need $500 to launch the thing. Now, the moment you launch the thing, you have now fulfilled your obligation. Everybody who gives that $500 is able to point to the thing that you made and say, I did that. I made that possible. What you have right now, launching a daily show, even after people give money, people are like, well, is it daily? And then people are thinking, well, is it a show or is this just a live stream? I didn't really think I was buying a live stream. People will feel ownership of whatever you define the target as. And I would say the target of creating a daily YouTube show, probably a bit of a thornier patch than you had expected. Is that fair to say, Bryce?
Yeah. Like,
I think this is, we're dancing around. It's hell. It's not.
Our lives are hell.
No. None of us do a daily YouTube show. There's a reason why the people that have done it and have done it well, it is their lifestyle.
Yeah.
Like, it is not.
Well, it's all they do. And more importantly, those people who can accomplish that are the kind of people who would do it whether they ever got a dime or not. It's just in them. And this is a way to let it out.
Yeah. I remember when Tom was shifting in the aftermath of leaving Twit, you know, talking to him and he's like, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do next. And I'm like, you're going to do another show because you wake up every day and you make a show. It's what you've done. It's what you will continue to do. And it was, right? Because he has a talent for it. He has rearranged part of his life to do it. And that is just a capacity for him. But you got to build that capacity. So, all right. So here's our official recommendation. Minimum viable product. We can do this for X. And here's exactly what we want. Here are the Amazon links. Here's exactly what we want to do. And here is and in fact we've already bought it.
That's a really, really good point. Is the definable endpoint right now? I haven't seen anything on the Kickstarter that is the definable endpoint. You, Bryce, when you said it, you're like, mm-hmm. Give me this money and you will get a CD.
Yeah.
And I gave you money and I got a CD. You know, me, I was like, you know, send me money and I'll send you this pint glass filled with awesome magic crap. Mm-hmm. And I did that. Contender, yep. Exact same thing. For FSL, it was, we will deliver one full season if you back this. And you did that. Yeah. Have your end point, whatever it is. Please, for the love of God, don't obligate yourself. You will come to hate the people who have made your dream possible.
And don't fall into the trap of thinking, then we'll do a Kickstarter every year.
Nope.
Because the huge name people who have tried to do that stopped doing that.
Yeah, even 99% Invisible figured out that it's like, oh, we can't just keep pressing that button.
Even Penny Arcade was going to do that, I believe. I think they were going to do it every year. I know they did one at some point. I thought my recollection is that they were going to do one every year, and that hasn't happened. Because it's just not a good way to do it. If you're trying to do something like that, consider a Patreon or something that is tied to what you make.
That's actually a really good point, is as far as monetizing content, Kickstarter's lousy. It's great for a movie, and that's it. Or a book or a comic or whatever. That's great. But if what you want to do is ongoing, I would never in a million years recommend Kickstarter first.
No, I mean, you can build it on top of it. You can say, oh, we're going to do a big event and we need X amount of money. You know, you can say we're going to do a spinoff thing. But you're right, man. Beginning, middle, and end. Like, that is absolutely the thing. And listen, the Patreon, we are all very happy with Patreon.
It's been pretty great.
I mean, to be fair, on the backside of things, Patreon has done a lot to make their whole system better. About maybe 6 months ago, there were artists who were on Tumblr who were saying, hey, people are pirating my work. They are putting up pledge money, downloading everything, and then leaving.
Right.
Patreon just
this was
out
to get access to secret exclusives. People would pledge, they would consume the media, and then they would
delete their pledge.
Yeah.
So now Patreon has the ability to charge your patrons
up front.
Like the people who are behind Patreon, this is not like PayPal. Like Patreon so far like feels like something that is aware that they are making a system for creators and are adapting to the needs of those creators. So like if that's not something to be worried about with Patreon, Ray using it.
And listen, I think that there's a great symbiotic community. You know, I mean, I've certainly seen it with the Jury Patreon, where, you know, that was something where I launched another show. And I launched another show because we I forget whether or not that was something that we pushed over a limit to do politics, or I just started doing politics and said, like, hey, look, now you have another way to do it. But like we did the In Your House tour, which was like, hey, let's get over 7. If we can get over 7, I'll do a live show, a weekend of live shows, right? Live shows and meetups. But that, again, that's once the crank is already cranking, you know, like that's, you know, you gotta make sure that people are getting something for their money, because, you know, just getting money is, you know, that's easier than you think. You can rob people, you know, it's having people give you money and be happy about it. That's the real.
Okay, so as a practical affair, if we're going to wrap things up by writing a prescription, I would say, you know, there's really two factors that people want on any of these campaigns. They want to know what's the thing and why should I believe you? And both of those have to be extremely, extremely strong. What's the thing needs to be clear as possible. Daily show about tech geek, blah, 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 blah. That sounds like literally that's half nothing. The content on YouTube.
Right.
Why should we believe you? Because of the one video we're seeing, probably not enough to actually commit money.
There's a track record behind that specifically.
Yeah, exactly. You can show, you know, anyway, that's it. That's all I say.
For me, when I go to look at a Kickstarter, I want to see like what the money is going to be used for. Very specifically, I look for that. Like, it's going to go for developers or art or equipment or software or whatever. Like, that's a huge thing. And then I do look at what you can do to prove that this thing is going to be good, whether it's a demo of something that exists, a series of videos, or, you know, a back catalog of whatever it is that you're rebooting or pushing up. And if I don't see either of those things, then I'm going to take what is in every Kickstarter at its word, is that if it doesn't get funded, they will do it anyway, and just kind of wait to see how the dice roll.
Yeah,
out.
That's a good elephant in the room. In the early days of Kickstarter, it was always, if everybody pitches in, then we'll do it. Nowadays, ain't nobody believes that. It's just, hey, I'm doing a thing. Would you like to give me money to support it? That's a different proposition.
Yeah.
And that's fine.
One last thing when it comes to Kickstarters. And this is a hard thing to really put your finger on. But for me, And I think this is one of those things that we might not say we notice, but your brain noticed, is does this project look like it's had more effort put into it than I would have put into it?
Mm.
Like, it always made me, I always kind of had a curiosity as to why so many Kickstarters had pictures and graphics and, like, you know, but wait, you know, like those like fun little things that are a part of, you know, the campaign text, right?
Right.
Graphics and stuff. And I kind of realized when we were doing the Contender one, it's because this shows how much effort I put into this. Imagine what we're going to put into what we're asking for. You know?
Yeah.
Like, that's something that says, like that, all that art, despite the fact that all the designs wind up being very different.
Well, like, and you look at this, right? So, like, you've just got images. You've got images here of what the people are going to get.
It looks like a store.
It looks like a store. And, like, they, for all accounts, you don't need this. You could just have the title.
Yeah,
and
theoretically, if we were all not human beings, the text is all that would matter. Would be enough, a description of what you buy.
But you... It shows you care enough about the project to make something that is visual and can be understood. Like, the amount of effort that you put into something does, on this level, get reflected, because it shows that you actually care about the people who are you are pitching to, basically.
So, just in general, this is a general Kickstarter thing. Put in more effort.
Mm-hmm.
All of it. Always make your effort, like, just shine. That is a faucet for money. And if you are not turning it, then you don't want money.
I mean, make some quick Photoshop images. Like the scant amount of time it would take to create resources and images and assets is, like, that's polish. That is the polish. Yeah. And you starting your Kickstarter a week early because you didn't do these images, like, ain't going to help you any.
By the way, if I'm these guys and I'm picturing listening right now, I would think that the one thing I would want very much to say is, you guys didn't even look at the product. You didn't even read the description. And understand, I'm pretty sure everything we've said so far, first of all, you're accurate. You're right. Number two, I'm pretty sure that everything we've said applies to the literal best product in the world. If what you had was the best thing in the world, I'm pretty sure everything we've suggested about Kickstarter and about Patreon and about the nature of creating mm-hmm. products and stuff still applies. Yeah. Is that right?
Oh, 100%. I mean, if we come off as saying, like, passionate about this and saying, oh, well, maybe you should do this or you shouldn't do that, it is not out of, like, trying to squash it. It is because it is that failure, fear of failure, that fear of it not going the way we want is, like, wake us up in the dead of night, cold sweat, terrified.
Yes, yes. Okay, real quick. Open by you in the chat says, it's good advice, it just sounds like don't do it. And nope. That's a really good point. That's not what we're about. We think you absolutely should do it. So, Blue Sky, and from the beginning, we say, why are you waiting until you get $5,000 to start? If this is something you love, if it's something you want to do, I don't understand why you're not doing it today, why you're not doing it tomorrow. Whatever it is you need, you'll be able to get it over the next month, 6 months, or whatever. And when it comes, if you need money, you'll be able to collect it. You'll be in a much better position 6 months from now. So do the thing. Don't sit there with your arms crossed and say, well, I do a really good song and dance routine. Oh, do you? Yes, and you'll find out just how great it is if you put $5 in my till. Until then, I'm going to pretend you're not there. No, don't be that guy. Get out there, do the thing. Figure out how to make it as good as possible.
Don't be that very articulate straw man that Brian just built.
And it's not like $5,000 is like, hey, we're changing our lives.
Yeah,
this money.
That's the other thing, right? That ain't lottery money.
The other thing is, man, I don't know if you could pay me enough money to do a daily YouTube show. that is a legitimate, like, unless you are giving me life-changing buy-a-house money, and a multi-year contract for which I can drop projects and break up friendships and damage my marriage because of it. Like, I don't know if that's something that, I mean, like, God, I did Weird Things TV, I think was twice weekly. And that was such a pain in the ass. It's hard. It's real, especially if you want to be ambitious, because it steps on your ambition. Mm-hmm. It just chokes your ambition the hell out.
It becomes the obligation that sucks up all of your free time, right? It's like the difference between before and after you quit your day job is largely, you know, unlocking 40 hours a week and for your creative endeavors. And once you take even a penny, all of a sudden every moment of that becomes capturing that 40 hours a week.
Yeah. It's man, I'm excited if they write back.
Please yeah. Tell me that we didn't just crush dreams.
We want it to be a dialogue. And here's the other thing, you know, and this is just about in general. We started like how to launch this in a crowded space. Here's the secret. Doesn't matter what genre you're doing. Doesn't matter how many other people do it. Doesn't matter if the most famous person in the world is doing something that has exactly what your description would be, because that is famous because they are them and you are you. You will never be the same person.
And we've
tried to imitate them. If you are good, people will be there for your personality, not for the content.
We've talked about this before. The only step to take is going from zero to anything. Anything after one. Anything after something, anything after not zero, is a matter of fidelity. Whether you're making $1 billion a minute or whether you're making $1,000 a year, you have gone from nothing to something. And so if you can, figure out a way to go to something immediately and worry about, you know, $5,000 down the road.
Yeah.
There we go. And no, Ren Igu, we're not setting up the Make Ashley Paramore Single Again Kickstarter. That's inappropriate. And I'm probably doing more than enough for free on that front.
Man, real quick, picks. I am reading Chuck Klosterman's book, But What If We're Wrong? And I am enjoying it so very, very much. I didn't expect it. It's... What's that?
I Wear the Black Hat?
I don't know, actually. I know that I know the name Chuck Klosterman. I don't even know from where. I assume he's some famous columnist from some place. It is. I Wear the Black Hat. Good job. Enjoying it immensely. He writes in a very approachable, very in the moment. It feels like every one of the chapters is an email to me. Like it a lot. And as a matter of fact, last week I talked about a beautiful constraint. Unfortunately, while I love the ideas in the books, I thought the writing was very tedious and the execution on the audiobook was very tedious. So it was a slog to get through that. But all of a sudden, this feels like a fresh breath of fresh air. But what if we're wrong? It's fantastic.
Klosterman's great. I'll pick I Wear the Black Hat. It's his book, Ruminating on Villains, real and imagined, and why we love them, why we hate them. Klosterman's writing is fantastic, and I enjoyed it. So get all up in it.
Yeah,
awesome.
I'm trying to think. If I've got a pick. Okay, you know what? I've got a pick, and I need to look it up because I no longer remember the name of it, but I do really, really like it. It is an album called Best Blues, that's it, from Small Black. I've mentioned this maybe on a pre-show or something. This is an album that I found in the past 2 weeks or so, and I adore it. It is this indie, it's this mix of like indie rock and like post rock sort of like noise. It's I think of it as just like kind of hipster trash rock. And I love it.
You're really selling it, man. Yeah. It's going great. Hipster trash rock. Can't wait.
Like, I got things that I like. check that out. Best Blues by Small Black. It's on Spotify and Apple Music and stuff.
Awesome.
By the way, I love that we both plug Klosterman books, and then Bryce just did his Chuck Klosterman impression to give us his musical description.
It's pretty good, actually.
All right, folks. All your dreams are worthless. It's been After.
Please write us.
All right.
Oh, dude, I did not think that would be such a rich vein to tap. The more I thought about it, like at first I'm like, oh yeah, no, it's a thing. Guys trying to do a thing. But I'm glad you took us to the uncomfortable territory, Justin, of actually saying, like, all of you, knock it off. Stop it.
Well, I mean, it's out of love, man. Like, I'm, you know.
Well, it's like
I'll tell you what, one of these days, I hope maybe it's at South by Southwest, maybe it's at Dragon Con, but, you know, Nerdtacular, something like that. But you find a kind of bleary-eyed, 2 a.m. post-show Justin and Brian.
Yeah.
Upon us. And you get the unfiltered, this is the warts and all of things that have gone well and things that have gone wrong, either that we have been in charge of or we have been trusted with, knowledge of. And it's like, there is a clear pattern, man. Like this isn't black magic. Like you can predict, like, success is often elusive. You got to find that spark, and that spark is never always in exactly the same places. There are ways where you can triangulate it, but failure, problems, systemic problems, man, you ain't got to be a naval engineer to spot a gigantic crack in a hull.
So I feel bad that I didn't mention this during the show, but I realized that the social psychology take on what we were talking about is called the fundamental attribution error. And it's it's the tendency for people to place an undue emphasis on internal characteristics rather than external factors. And this is a case where they are looking at the thing they want to do, and it's so clearly and obviously good that they have not looked at or have failed to understand the incredibly strong, important external factors of the way people buy things on Kickstarters, what makes for a good Kickstarter, how this will affect their life and you know, everything.
Yeah, man. I mean, like, then there's also the element, just go. Just make
do
it.
Do what you can, yeah.
Make it. Because guess what? Like, you're not going to like the first thing you make.
Yeah.
Like, man, if you want to do a daily YouTube show or, like, all right, number one, you're
insane. Dude, if you've ever made a thing and you hate it, imagine how much more you'll hate that thing when you've collected $5,000 from every person who's ever mattered to you in your life. Imagine how much more you'll want to kick it in the face.
Mm-hmm. Well, and also, like, to start off at daily is crazy in itself, but I think to give any sort of definitive timetable is real, real tough. Just for, like, outside of the Kickstarter, like, to say I want to do a project that has this strict timetable is not always great. Like, I think about my playlist thing, and every time I talk about it, I never try to say it's every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks, because it's not. It's always going to be different because my own stuff is going on. You know, if you're doing, unless you are, like, you know, boots on the ground every day, only doing this thing, then maybe, but that's probably, statistically, that's unlikely that you're doing that.
Yeah,
ahoy.
Oh boy.
Ma'am, ahoy.
Hey, do we officially have a time for weird things? Night Attack. Not good things. Night Attack.
Speaking of which, we spoke, what, yesterday or the day before? I apologize that I didn't reach out to you, Bryce. We were talking about doing it earlier on Tuesday because...
Before your show?
Yes, because apparently after the show, they like to do pizza and beer and all that stuff.
Right.
And I don't want to... Justin said earlier works out for him if it works out for you. The only question is our guest.
Okay, I'll find out.
Okay, cool.
I'll find out. My guess is earlier will probably be better than later since I believe he has a new child in the house. So,
oh, yeah. So we can wake that baby up in the middle of its nap.
What? How early do you guys have a time? Just pick a time.
Okay. Well, I get in Monday. Yeah, we'll pick a time. I'll be on East Coast time, so it'll probably be pretty early in the day, like close to noonish, I would imagine.
Oh, okay. Early.
Or I guess 2. Well, we're gonna be on opposite coasts. So if we do 2 o'clock Central, that's 3 my here. Time, which I think would get me there early enough to set up. Ooh, maybe 1.
Central
time. Noon or 1 or so would be ideal.
That's
for
a morning show for me.
Yeah, that's not... I apologize, but...
Do you want to just say noon Central right now so that I can go and say...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Does that work for you, Justin, 10 a.m.? Your time?
Yep.
Okay.
Wait.
Yes. Wait, are you doing the morning stream?
Yeah, so I'll basically come right out of the morning stream into Night Attack.
Okay.
Into the night stream. From the morning stream to the night stream. Maybe that's what we'll call the show.
Yeah, all right, cool. I can do that.
Cool.
Morning Attack.
Morning Attack.
Euro-friendly.
Euro-friendly.
You got jury today?
Jury tonight.
Tonight. Mm.
7 o'clock.
Tonight.
Hey, don't forget to check out that Dan Harmon thing.
The what? The thing.
What is it? Notable History Man?
We definitely won't watch it the moment we go off the air. Until then, bye!
Goodbye, everyone!
We suddenly gotta go!
Oh, shit! We remembered something!